Senate President Bill Cole joined me in our Charleston studio earlier this week to take on many of the same issues discussed by his fellow candidates today. Senate President Bill Cole, thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure.
I want to start with the budget today. You, the House Speaker, the Governor, you're still in talks to handle the 2017 budget that has to be approved by June of this year, but I want to move beyond that. Okay. The trend for the past couple years has been that revenues are down. The decline has continued, and it's not likely that the next governor will find an immediate solution and come in with more money than they know what to do with. That's probably not going to happen. If you were to become the next governor, in terms of inheriting these budgetary issues, would you look to a mix of cuts, of revenue increases, of one-time monies to balance the budget? During your administration, what is your outlook on moving the state forward in terms of the budget?
Good question. I think, first of all, you don't ever take any option off the table. When we're dealing with tough times, and we are in West Virginia, I think you have to consider all the answers, all the possible answers. I think part of it will continue to fall to right-sizing our state government. We're about 20% larger in dollars per capita and spent on our state government than the average in this country. So if we just want to be average, and I don't know that anybody ever aspires to be average, I think there's 20% available. But that takes surgical precision, if you will, and that can only come from the executive branch. We need to make sure as we cut or we right size state government that we don't hurt programs that are necessary or that are really doing the good that's necessary. So part of it is in savings in state government. Part of it is in revenue. And by revenue, instead of raising taxes, which I think there's little desire for, we need to look for ways to put West Virginians back to work. And so the last 2 years in the legislature, we've passed those laws that are in legal reforms and regulatory reforms that I believe will enhance our opportunity, our ability to go out and sell West Virginia to outside companies and people that'll put West Virginians to work. We have West Virginians work, and all of a sudden we have a revenue stream coming back into state government. So, you know, it's part save our way there and it's part sell our way there, but we will get there.
This idea of surgically cutting, of making specific cuts in certain programs, you've brought that up in the past. It is something that the governor is able to do. Should you take that position, what do you see as being able to be cut? What specific programs or specific areas?
You know, I think as we, if you look, for instance, at the highways audit that we did last year, that suggested there was $25 to $50 million in savings. That's before there was any consideration of fraud or corruption, and we know from indictments and things that have gone on that there is that, or at least there has been that in the past. So I don't think there's any government agency that shouldn't be held up, you know, and held accountable to proper operations. I think there's opportunities to privatize things. We've struggled with PEIA. Remember when we had when the workers' comp program, that thing about went under, and finally that was privatized and is working well. So I think PEIA is something that we could look to privatize as well. I think everywhere you turn, I think if we take a business look, a business view at how we run state government, we might do things more efficiently. And remember, I'm a longtime business guy, so I do tend to look at that through that business prism as I look at the operation of state government.
Well, let's move on to economics a little bit since you bring that up. You serve as the Senate president, but you've been elected specifically from Southern West Virginia. Mm-hmm. And Southern West Virginia is an area that's struggling economically. Many people in the state would argue that coal could come back, but if you look to representatives of utilities, specifically Appalachian Power, they've said, you know, even if the Clean Power Plan, President Obama's plan to cut carbon emissions, even if that doesn't take effect, we're still going to shift our energy mix away from coal. Keeping that in mind, what specific plans, specific policy initiatives do you think you could put in place as governor to help move Southern West Virginia beyond its reliance on coal mining?
Sure. Well, again, we need to look for ways to put people to work. Particularly our coal miners, our displaced coal miners, and frankly, all the associated businesses. We always talk about just the coal miner, but there's four or five or six associated jobs that depend on each coal mining spot. We're looking at different options. When we have surface mining and the post mine land use permits, say put it back on exactly, make the mountain look like the mountain. Again, where we can have flat land all of a sudden in West Virginia, maybe we put it to a different use. And I know Hobet is one that the governor's working hard. The new airport in Mingo County is a great example of properly utilizing or utilizing in a different way those post-mine land use issues. So we're looking, for instance, there's a manufacturing company right now that's actually in final negotiation for land, and will intend to put as many as 400 to 600 miners back to work in that'll be in Southern Kanawha County. I think there are opportunities, but I think it takes. I say often that our next governor, hopefully that's me, needs to be also the chief executive salesman. We need to take the good stories that have come out of our last two legislative sessions and go out and knock on the boardroom doors around this country. We can't change our laws and then hope that these companies line up at our border and say, can we be next to be in West Virginia? We've got to go out and sell it and sell West Virginia, sell our people and our geographic location, and I intend to do just exactly that. So we can put people back to work and they can be in different industries, but there are opportunities.
If we can move to northern West Virginia, kind of along the same lines, and talk about the natural gas industry. Right now, because of low prices, that industry is seeing layoffs as well. The industry does believe that if prices go up and natural gas becomes more expensive, the Marcellus and the Utica shale plays in West Virginia, as well as some others, can rebound. How do you, as a leader of the state, ensure that should this rebound occur, West Virginia doesn't end up with a boom and bust industry in North Central and Northern West Virginia that does not provide long-lasting jobs in that region?
Well, that's a good question. I think the thing that caught West Virginia was that we were so singly tied to the coal industry that the boom and bust happens. I agree with you. We can't fall into that trap again. But the way we do that is we diversify. We diversify our economy. We look for the other opportunities to bring those job creators to West Virginia. Building out our high-speed broadband network is critical, is imperative if we move forward. There's so many opportunities with the jobs of tomorrow. Telecommuting, telemedicine, when we have tough issues in rural West Virginia. So we diversify, but we need to work very hard to make sure that we do everything to be supportive of our gas industry, because those opportunities, you didn't mention Rogersville. I mean, the opportunities there are phenomenal. We need to build infrastructure. We need to build pipelines. We need to get the gas to market, and that will help recover the prices. But gas can be, it shouldn't be the single thing we depend on. What it should be is the icing on the cake. It should be what moves West Virginia from good to great, or from, one of the poorest states in the nation to one of the richest.
Well, you bring up the issue of pipelines, and last year West Virginia attracted a pretty big conference. The National Governors Association met at the Greenbrier last summer. I know you attended just briefly to kind of meet some people. And I spoke with Terry McAuliffe, who's the governor of Virginia right now, at that conference about pipelines. They're trying to take gas from north central West Virginia, ship it to Virginia and to North Carolina. And one of the things he said to me was, we can use West Virginia natural gas to reinvigorate manufacturing in Virginia. He already has plans in the works that should those pipelines spread into Virginia, will create downstream jobs. Why are we not hearing that in West Virginia? Is that something that you want to look at?
Oh, absolutely. Listen, it's all the above. You know, people say, well, don't be like coal. Don't be a one-way ticket out of here. If we started shipping all the gas we could ship tomorrow, none of us will be around to see the end of it. We have, the reserves are so incredible, so deep. But we need to make sure that we do the right things and make the state a desirable place to attract an ethane cracker or two. And once we have that, the downstream manufacturing opportunities in the plastics industry and all are incredible for our wet gas. So yes, absolutely, we want to work hard to attract those opportunities. But in the meantime, I want to provide gas to as many people as we can. And he is right. I mean, it is low cost energy, and it does make us competitive on the world market with our manufacturing capabilities. So it's a huge win for West Virginia.
Well, you also brought up broadband, excuse me. Expanding access to broadband was a big issue during this legislative session. There were plans from multiple senators even on how to do that properly. Expanded access, I think, is not just good for citizens, it's also good for attracting jobs, specifically technology jobs. The debate this session was whether or not government should get involved in expanding that access. Where do you fall on this issue? Should government get involved in expanding access to broadband, or should it be left to the free market?
You know, like I said earlier, I don't know that government is where we need to go for a lot of solutions, and certainly not business solutions. I think government needs to facilitate the conversation. I think we need to push it along. We need to demand it along. I don't want to see state government running our broadband network, but we need to do everything we can do to get the interested parties together and provide that internet access to every home, every household in West Virginia. And when you think about the, you know, I mentioned telemedicine a little bit earlier, the opportunity to put our schools on track with the jobs of tomorrow. I mean, we should be teaching computer coding classes in high school. We should have our kids coming out of high school or maybe two-year technical college through a computer sciences class, ready to take those jobs. So, you know, Wirt County High School, and they're a one-to-one school. Every kid has a tablet. There's smart boards in every room. The energy is unbelievable. I mean, the kids are learning, the teachers are engaged, the kids are engaged. It was a great experience. I'd like to see that through every classroom in West Virginia. We need to move our kids to the front of the front of the pack.
Well, that leads perfectly into my next question about education, because education was a hot topic this session as well, specifically about Common Core, which West Virginia has repealed and replaced with other education standards. But still in the House, very concerned over the science standards and what it is students are learning about climate change. What do you think West Virginia students should be learning in their public school classrooms about climate change?
You know, I think that When public education starts to create opinions, or opinions start coming through, I think we failed our kids. I think that our kids need given access to the facts and then taught how to properly think through it for themselves. Let them deduce or decide that it's real, that it's not real, that it's caused by something that man does, or it's a normal cycle in the life of our planet. But I want to see us. We need to get focused on what's most important in education. I think it's, you know, we talk about Common Core and we talk about too much testing, which, by the way, I think that we do too much of. But at the end of the day, when we're investing 21st in dollars per student and getting a 48th place student achievement, we're failing our kids. And the quicker we get our focus back on our children and the proper outcome from their education, the better off we'll be. So I want to get focused on the students and then the teachers. We need to pay our teachers properly. If we want the best teachers, we need to pay them, just like any other business. But we got a lot of work to do in education.
So even though an overwhelming majority of scientists believe that climate change is real, they say the evidence is there, you still think students should be exposed to the minority opinion?
I think that, well, certainly, and I don't know that the majority opinion says climate change is real. I mean, it depends on who's coming up with the data. So, you know, but whether it is or it isn't, here's, you know, at the end of the day, we need to be focused on all that we can do to take care of our planet. We should lead the world in clean burn technology for our coal plants. We shouldn't have just shut our coal plants down, our coal-fired power plants down, but we could have been the leader in the world. We could have been teaching all the other countries that are gravitating towards coal-fired power plants, Japan and Germany and India and Pakistan. We should have been ready to teach them how to do it and do it right.
You've not been in the legislature for long, a term in the Senate, a short amount of time in the House as an appointee. Compared to some of your colleagues, that's a very short amount of time. As we head into the 2016 election, you know, we still have a very close majority in the Senate, and there's a possibility that it could switch and Democrats could take control of that chamber. With that in mind, can you give the people of West Virginia an example, a specific example of a time that you were able to reach across the aisle, as a governor inevitably has to do, and work with the opposite party to accomplish something that moved West Virginia forward?
You know, I think that I have to go back to my first year in leadership. We passed 262 bills. Every single one of them had bipartisan support. So it isn't I don't take lightly. I wasn't a bully with our one vote majority. I didn't say we're going to do it my way or the highway. I really sought to make all our legislation better, and I think you do that by having all both sides of the aisle, all sides of the issue. You bring everybody together and you try and come up with the best solution for West Virginia. If you don't get it exactly, you can circle back and amend it or fix it in an ensuing year. There were a couple of partisan issues that were straight party line votes this year, but I'm going to say that of all the legislation passed over 2 years, probably 1% was down a party line. So I think that would indicate that I do reach across the aisle. A good idea is a good idea. It doesn't make any difference whether it's a Democrat idea or Republican idea. Now, to the extent that I do very much believe that it's important for West Virginia that the Republicans retain the majority, it is only because the majority is who sets the agenda. We'll be taking up an agenda that will set the stage for West Virginia to attract the job creators, which are so critical for West Virginia's future. We have to put West Virginians back to work. We're the only state in the nation to ever fall below 50% in workforce participation, and we have to turn that around.
Democratic candidates participating in the forum will be asked to give a closing statement, and so we'd like to give you a similar opportunity. As the Republican candidate for governor, excuse me, I should say the inevitable Republican candidate for governor.
I think I have a pretty good chance on May 10th.
Why, tell the people of West Virginia, why should they vote for you?
You know, it's funny, as I've gone out and been all over the state and visited all 55 counties, I find myself making only one campaign promise so far. Now that may change, but my one promise is simply this: I will move forward with legislation that is for the benefit of our state, to put our people back to work, to make our state a better place to live, and hopefully keep our kids home rather than sending them away to find their fortune somewhere else. My promise is this: I won't make a vote or take up an issue or avoid an issue based on my desire to be reelected. I'm going to do what's right for West Virginia every single opportunity that I can. I believe it's imperative that we elect our next governor based on the fact that his heart's in the right place. I would offer that I have the right mindset. In my years in business and as a job creator, and I currently have over 400 people working for me in my businesses now, I think I have the right skill set. I have the right determination, drive, and desire to turn this state around. I genuinely believe that so much of what ails us all comes back to the opportunity for somebody to go to work and make a good living. So, you know, my solutions are going to be based around putting people to work.
Senate President Bill Cole, Republican candidate for governor, thank you so much.
Thank you.